so
if you don't stay long,
you don't stay long.
Please, Lord,
you do.
If you don't stay long,
you don't stay long.
Please, Lord,
you do.
Stop by,
stop by,
for
the tour.
Stop by. You, if you stop by, we already know that you will make everything all right. Stop by,
stop by, oh, for the tour.
Stop by,
stop by,
oh,
for the tour.
Stop by,
stop by, oh,
for the tour. If you don't stay long,
stop by here.
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 Stop by Counsel for our pastor. Give her a hearty amen as she comes, please.
Yes. I bet you when y'all was singing that song, stop by here. I bet she heard you the third time. I say he heard you. Ten, 15, 20 times. And I saw you pick up the mic. I said, no, he's not. Again? Well, well, well. I'll talk to you more when we get home tonight. I'm telling you. Like when you got a repeat thing like that, get you something new instead of the same thing. So it sounds like you're a little bit. Wow. Yeah. I was in the office. I said, I think he heard them already. Yeah, come out here. And he kept on. Stop by. I'm coming. You don't have to ask me anymore. I promise you I'll be there. For sure. Whoa. Thank God for the victory. Well, so much for that. It's good to be here tonight. And I know he's here. Yes. We told him, come on, stop by. And he said, I'm going to be there, I promise you. Don't worry about it. Oh, thank God for the victory. We're happy for all of you that are here tonight. And welcome to all of our visitors. We're glad that you came. We thank God for his blessings. And he continues to bless us more and more every day. It is a good time to praise God. When things are not going good, that's the best time to praise God. You couldn't have a better time. It's true. And I thank him for all that he's done, and I am excited about what he's going to do. Our guys are leaving Tuesday, going to Washington. They've been invited to come to we've got a conference there with over 6,000 journalists from all over the country. And they must be there. And we just don't know what all the Lord's going to do with this, but with the Washington Post article accompanying them there, I'm thinking we're going to get some serious outpouring. So you pray for them that God will be with them and strengthen them. They'll be going all the way to Saturday. The thing really ends on Sunday, but they know they're not going to be out of church, so they'll be back here on Saturday. And so continue to pray for them as they go on their journey. We have been in a long, long war. And I don't think you can fight this long without feeling the results, feeling all the things that go with that. And not just fighting this war, but constantly fighting. And so we're encouraged, and the Lord said, I don't know why they keep pushing that unless their conscience is bothering them about doing this to a church. Most people will not do this to a church. And for you to step out and do this and put your hand against God's work, you got to answer for that. There's no getting around it. You got to answer for it. So we're moving forward in that, and we're going to do what we need to do in getting things accomplished, and we can get it done. And I am thankful that God will let you know how to fight the war. Nothing is worse than going to war and not have a strategy, not understanding what you need to do at this time. That's important, very important. So I just think that it's good for us to look up and say, thank you for direction. If you didn't direct us, we wouldn't know what to do. But thank you for taking us by our hand and leading us on and helping us to get through, because we surely couldn't do it without you. So I'm thankful to the Lord for all that we've gone through. It's just been so many things. I said one time, boy, I mean, the devil's on the left, the devil's on the right. He's in the front, he's in the back. But we're still winning. That's what counts. We're winning. Yes. So I'm thankful for that. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 36th chapter of Jeremiah. Father, we're grateful tonight for your blessings, for all that you've done for us. It's a privilege to come and to worship you and lift you up in praise. I pray tonight that you would open your people's ears, cause them to receive the truth. Bind every spirit that's not like you. And we'll give you glory. We'll give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Yes. I'm going to be skipping around in this chapter because it's too long, and I'm not going to read the whole thing. It came to pass in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, that this word came unto Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, take thee a roll of a book and write therein all the words that I have spoken unto you against Israel and against Judah, against all the nations from the day I spake unto thee, from the days of Josiah even unto this day. And it may be that the house of Judah will hear all the evil which I purpose to do unto them, that they may return every man from his evil way, that I may forgive their iniquity and their sins. And I'm jumping down. Therefore, sixth verse, go thou and read in the roll which thou hast written from my mouth the words of the Lord in the ears of the people in the Lord's house upon the fasting day. And also thou shalt read them in the ears of all Judah that come out of their cities. It may be, it just may be, they will present their supplication before the Lord and will turn and will return everyone from his evil way. For great is the anger and the fury that the Lord has promised against his people. I'm not going to read all this. I'm going to tell you the rest of it. So now Jeremiah is in prison. So he can't go and deliver. So he tells Barak, said, I want you to take this word, write it down in a roll, and I want you to take this to the house of God and read to them the judgment that I'm going to bring on them because of their sin. So he did that. So as he began to read it, there were people that didn't agree with it. And so they hid it for a while before they told the king about it. And then they went to finally brought it before the king because he asked for it. And when they did, he listened to him read it. He did not like it. Because God is saying what I'm going to do to you is evil. So the king, he said, now the king sat in the winter house in the ninth month, and there was a fire on the hearth burning before him. And it came to pass that when Jehudi had read three or four leaves, he cut it with the penknife and cast it into the fire that was on the hearth until all the roll was consumed in the fire that was on the hearth. They were not afraid, nor rent their garments, neither the king or any of his servants that heard all these words. So he says, I'm not going to listen to this. What am I going to do with it? I'm going to cut it up and put it in the trash, put it in the fire. So you got to understand that, okay, God is speaking truth to these people, except they don't like it. And oftentimes do God speak truth to people and they don't like it. But he doesn't care if you don't like it. He already told the prophet, now this is a rebellious, stiff-necked people. They don't want to hear me. They ain't going to hear you. But I want you to tell them what I said. So I don't think that it's to the point that if people don't want to hear you, just don't say nothing. No, we need to say something. And so now he hears the word and he don't like it. God has sent all the judgment and the things he's going to bring against them for their sins. So as he's listening to it, by the time he got to the fourth part of it, he just started cutting it up and throwing it into the fire. And so he went back and God said to him, write it again. Write it again and present it again. One thing I want to make sure that you understand is that you cannot destroy truth. You can't do it. If once you hear it, you may not like it, you may not approve of it, but you can't change it. The scripture says we can't do nothing against the truth. All we can do is follow it. You can't do nothing against it. You can't destroy it. You can't dump it anywhere. That man thought burn it in the fire. Get rid of it. Here it comes again. How many times have people in their lifetime heard somebody tell them a truth, some truth, and then they travel somewhere in some other part of the country and somebody tells them the same truth? You'll never get away from it. Truth is the most powerful thing that we have in this world. There's two things that has power, evil and the truth. And the truth always wins. So I think you got to look at, don't be always expecting God to give you something that's cute and curly. It may not be, because you may not be cute and curly. So what do we want a prophecy that says to us that you're just a great person? God's going to bless you. He's going to do many things for you. We like those kind of prophecies. But we don't like the one where God says, I'm going to judge you for your sin. We don't like that, and we push that away as much as possible. We don't want no parts of it. And then we get mad with the messenger. That's why Jeremiah was in prison. They got tired of him telling them the truth. So they put him in prison. At this time, while he's in prison, look, I can't go, but take this for me. One thing I like about it, because he didn't have a role in the prison, but the man had the role. He said, now write what I tell you. Because if you go back to the point where God first spoke to Jeremiah, he said, eat all the roll. So the roll was in him. And I think we need more Christians with the word already in us. We don't know how to fight the enemy because we don't understand. He only respects the word of God. So if the word is in you, you can speak the word. He told Barak everything to put down, and word for word. And as it come out of my mouth, but he said once he chewed it up and once he ate it, it became a part of him. You can't forget it. You need to remember the word. If anybody ever comes to the point they throw Bibles in the trash and tell you throw yours away, you need to have the word in you. That if I don't have the book to read it, it's in here. I know what the word says do. I know exactly what it's saying because I study the word, because I meditate on the word. It's in my heart. Think about it. So when I looked at that, I thought, why is it that you get so angry when somebody tells you the truth? Why is that? Why is it that it rubs people in the wrong way? It's like, leave me alone. Here you come again with this stuff. You know what? God wouldn't have to repeat nothing to you if you did it the first time. It wouldn't keep coming back if you'd done it when he first told you to do it. But you don't want to do that. I want to be what I want to be, say what I want to say. And I have made a lot of enemies over the years that I've been saved because I never said what people wanted me to say. Because you don't give me what to say. He tells me what to say. And I better obey him and not you. That's for sure. So I looked at this and I thought, God, if you don't help people and if people don't yield themselves to God to say, Lord, whatever you want me to receive, help me receive it. Even if it sounds bad. Even if it makes you feel like crap. I'm going to take this because it's going to do something good for me. People, I oftentimes have seen this, they will have two responses. They'll either receive the truth when it first come, and then later they reject it. Or either they'll reject it from the beginning, and then on the other side they'll receive it after they can't get away with it. So you always see these different responses from people. But it's for your benefit. And God said, Rose, I need somebody I can count on that's going to say what I need them to say in spite of the fact they don't like it. Don't be alarmed at their face, how they look at you, what they think. Who cares about all that? As long as you get the message across, that's what makes the difference. See? So if you want to really, really be free, you got to be open to truth, whatever it is. And I'm telling you, there's enough ugly stuff in you that's going to resist it. But if you really want to be saved, you're going to have to accept that and say, that's true. Yeah, sometimes it's tough. Ethel, I think you remember the time that we were talking and you were telling me something about a situation and what have you. And I stopped you and said, no, this is what that is. That wasn't pretty. I wish I didn't over here, what you're talking about, ain't none of that what's going on. But what I just told you, that's truth. And she took it, and it changed who you were. Did it feel good? No. Did it feel like, well, you know, what else can I do? Here's what people say to me. I have done everything I know to do. I'm trying to understand, what else is it? You know, until you get straight, you're going to still be asking, what else is it? I'm coming back to get you. The word is not going to fold up because you got a little perturbed and put it on the altar and walk out. No, here it is. This is what it is. Take it. If you do that, you would be surprised how your life would change. And the things that you're fighting against, trying to get through and trying to get past, you'll find out, boy, this is so much more simpler than for you to cop an attitude. Don't get an attitude about it. See? That's why the word said, buy the truth, sell it not. Don't get rid of it. Purchase it. Hold on to it. Don't ever trade it in. Don't ever do anything. Deal with who you are. See? Let me tell you about somebody over here in the Word. I think I got it marked off. They were getting ready to go to battle. And the king of Syria wanted Jehoshaphat to go with him. So Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, inquire, pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. Then the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, his prophets. See, they're your prophets. They say what you want to hear. There's a lot of them. They'll say exactly what you want to hear. Look at this. 400 men. And said unto them, shall I go against Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear? And they said, go up, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. And Jehoshaphat said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord that we might inquire of him? Because these lying prophets you got here ain't working. He recognized they were lying prophets. So listen to what the king says. He says, the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, there is yet one man, Micah, the son of Imlah, by whom we may inquire of the Lord, but I hate him. Listen to this. He said, we can inquire of him for the Lord. And he says, for he doth not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. And Jehoshaphat said, let not the king say so. Don't say that. That's what he did. I don't like him. They usually don't like the preacher that shoots straight from the hip. That don't cut no corners. Just say it like it is. Here it is. And so he finally called Micah and asked him, and this is what they said to him. The messenger said, was gone to Micah, spake unto him, saying, behold, now the words of the prophets declare good unto the king with one mouth. Let thy word, I pray thee, be like the word of one of them, and speak that which is good. Now, we already had our prophets to tell us good, and we're going to ask you to do the same. So he said, Micah said, as the Lord liveth, what the Lord saith unto me, that will I speak. But I like this down here when he kind of played with him a little bit. It says, so he came to the king, and the king said unto him, Michael, shall we go up against Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall we forbear? And he answered him, go and prosper, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. You want me to say that? And the king said unto him, how many times shall I adjure thee that thou tell me nothing but the truth, that which is true in the name of the Lord? He knew, now you don't want to hear what he got to say, but now you're telling, I adjure you to tell me the truth. So he said, I saw all Israel scattered upon the hills as sheep that have not a shepherd. And the Lord said, these have no master, let them return every man to his house in peace. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, did I not tell thee that he would prophesy no good concerning me? Did not I just tell you he ain't no good? The problem is, Prophecy will be good to you if you are good. Prophecy will come to you because you are good. You get a good prophecy. But if you ain't doing right, don't think God just going to look over it and prophesy a lie to you. That's not going to happen. See? And so he said, hear therefore now the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne and all the hosts of heaven standing by him on his right hand and the left. And the Lord said, who shall persuade Ahab that he may go and fall at Ramoth Gilead? And one sit on this manner and another sit on that manner. And there came forth a spirit and stood before the Lord and said, I'll persuade him. I'll persuade him to do the wrong thing. I'll be the one. There is lying spirits that literally speak to people that tell them, you ought to do this. And this is God. No, it's not. I remember the first time that Gary called me when he first started turning on me and lying. He hadn't got so deep in as he was now. And he called me and he was crying. He said, I'm so sorry for all the lies I told on you. I said, well, Gary, just ask the Lord to forgive you because I don't have no problem. He said, I can never forgive myself for what I did to you. This is the first call. I said this to him. Satan had an agent waiting there for him. And he fed him piece by piece by piece. And I said to him, the only way you'll be able to overcome this, get back with the men, get away from that agent who Satan has assigned for your destruction. And he said, I will. Mama, please forgive me. Please forgive me. I said, I do. I don't even know what you said, but I still forgive you. He didn't do that. And so he finally said to himself, I'm not listening to nothing that I'm in say, because I know what they're going to say. So he closed the door on truth. You never close the door on truth. Because I'm telling you, there's nothing left on the other side but a lying spirit to tell you a bunch of lies and tell you these things that's not true. The devil talks to people's mind. They better get real. They better understand that. Well, she don't like me. See how she treats me. Well, she's looking at me funny. I say, look, you're going to get off of me. There is no reason for me to have a funniness about nothing. I'm not going to let you make me feel a little funny, a little peculiar, a little strange. If that little strange isn't there, you better get rid of it. Because I'm telling you, it's always him. God doesn't come in a strange way like that. He talks to your mind. And it deceives people, and they believe it. I told him, I said, you'll never survive it unless you get to those guys. And a short period, Demetrius talked to him, and he said, yeah, that's true. That's true. And after a while, that guy just kept putting this stuff. And she's this, and she's that. This man don't even know me. You know me. 29 years, you know me. This man don't know who I am, and he's telling you all who I am. You going to believe somebody that's a crook? You know me well. But he kept going. He stayed with him until he is so bound. God is going to have to crush him. And he will. That muscle disease the Lord healed him of when he first came to the church, he had a bad muscle disease. At one point, he could only crawl on the floor to the bathroom. He couldn't stand up because the disease was eating away the muscles. Well, now it's back. And he's got 3 or 4 different inhalers he have to use for different things. But the disease is back. Now, the scripture says, go and sin no more. Least. A worse thing. Now the disease will be worse this time than it ever was the first time. You should have never did that. The price you pay for saying, I'm not going to believe the truth. You know I never lied to nobody. You know I always told people the truth. Yes. You know I never painted some picture that wasn't real. You know when I said God said, he said. Every time you know that. But another, let me tell you this. You may sit in this church and hear me preach again and again. And deep inside, I don't like that. I'm telling you, look at me in my face, Sam. That's right. But deep down inside, that feeling that I don't care for her. All because what she said struck me very hard. And I'm not liking the fact that I got to deal with this. And why would you go there? Why would you go there? And so a man told me one time, Curtis was here in the church, and he said the Lord showed me something about his personal life. And, ooh, he got mad. And he said, I asked the Lord not to tell you about that. You won't sin and ask God to cover it up? Are you stupid? I was asking the Lord, don't tell you that. Well, he told me. Now, what are you going to do about it? You can't change it. That boy was so mad with me. Oh, my God. He was angry, and he showed it. Sometimes when you get the truth, it hits so hard, it cuts you in half. Go down into the marrow of the bone, into every part of who you are. And you can try to fix that if you want to, but at the end of the day, you're going to have to deal with it. It ain't going away, and I'm not going away. So what he does, he turns you on the messenger. I'm the messenger. I didn't send the message. I'm the one who delivers it. So since God is up in heaven, he's around here too, but you don't see him and you don't know him, so you take it out on me. I'm just a postman. I'm bringing you here. This is what the Lord said. You better listen to this. I can hear what you don't hear. I see what you don't see. And I'm thinking, but if you have an open heart to say, I take that, you're going to feel better. Angel, you feel a whole completely different. Totally different. But she had never had the truth told to her the way I told it to her. It was always, Angel, Angel, Angel. That time it was not Angel. And she's, what? I mean, she was just having a temper tantrum. I said, it's okay. Just send it away. And then she said, Mom, I said, don't call me Mom, I'm Sister Rose to you. Oh, my God. What? So, I can't call you Mom. No, no. Sister Rose. She said, Mama, that was the darkest day of my life. I thought, what have I done? But she changed it. And we talked this week, and it's been some time ago, but we talked this week. I mean, it's phenomenal what that truth did. It's phenomenal. It just changed it and fixed everything right. Quit getting upset about the truth. See, some people ain't heard it from me yet. The Lord is preparing you. Because I will show up with the truth. Here it is. Why, how could you say that to me? Easy? Easy. I did that to, you better say, William. That boy got truth so hard until I felt it. I mean, I felt like I was on the other end of it. So after he got the truth, put it all on the table, I left it there. But then, after a few days, he's looking like this. You know what? He's struggling with taking it. I don't want to believe this. Is it that bad? I told him the same thing. He said, Mama, I said, I'm Sister Rose. Anytime you don't take truth from me, I'm Sister Rose. I ain't Mama. Don't even go there. Mama is an endearing word. You ain't endearing. Called him a few days later, way later, and I said, I still love you, but I had to tell you that. I know, Mom. I let him have it then. Because now he's, I know, Mom, I know. Okay, I'll let you have it. But if you fight it, you're going to have a difficult time serving God. I'm telling you, you're going to have a hard time. There are some people I can go to in this church, and the minute I go to them and say, this, you should do something. Okay, Sister Rose, no fight, no nothing. But then you got some bulldogs. I mean, they ready. Just come with it if you want to. I'm ready for you, and I'm surely ready for you. I'm not going to back down. Take a back seat. Because you're not going to be better because of it. You'll be worse. See? So understand that. God said, I'm going to warn you that I'm going to send judgment to you. And what are you going to do? What are you going to do? I said to Bernard the other day, a week or so ago. I said, boy, my legs are hurting so bad from working out. I said, do your legs hurt bad when you work out? That's a tough question. So he's standing there. I'm knowing his head is way bigger than it was. And he's standing there looking at me like this. I said, do your legs hurt when you work out? Why you want to ask me that? Because it's just the truth. Answer it. Answer it. No, his legs ain't hurting. His legs is up on the table with some chicken. And anything else he can find. His legs ain't hurting. I said, Bernard. So I keep saying, Bernard. I'm going to get a call that you got a heart attack. You had a heart attack. Bernard, I'm going to hear that you had a heart attack. Keep saying that. Today, why you keep saying that? Because you're going to have a heart attack. And you can't say she didn't tell me. I expect that. Because the warning has been many. When you get many warnings, what you going to do with it? He that is being often reproved and harden his neck becomes stubborn and self-willed. He said he shall be utterly destroyed without any hope. Come on. You don't want to get to the place where you're laying there hooked up to life support. Come on. The message keeps coming, but we don't listen to it. We keep saying no. We keep putting it off. Think about it. You got to make up in your mind, I got to receive this truth. Like that man said, he only prophesies to me bad stuff. Well, get right, and he'll prophesy to you some good stuff. It's nothing like a good thing from the Lord, a good word from him because of you, of what you've done, how you've been faithful and all this. And he's going to bless. There's nothing better than that. But if you don't walk right, they ain't going to always be that way. See? Yeah. I look at Aaron, and I think sometimes, you look so tired because you're in a warfare with your flesh. And with what's right. God, if I could get this monkey off my back. He ain't getting off your back. I tied him around your neck. Every time I try to shake it off, you know, I can't get rid of it. Because what you used to could do and it wouldn't bother you, now if you think about it, it's like you got to get yourself together, boy. That's what you say. You don't know, man. You don't know. Man, but you ain't going to shake it off. You should have never came here. You should have never came here. Because when I tell you, you will never be able to do what you've done before and do it with, I ain't going to worry about it. Oh, now you are. Because now you know it's wrong. See, Jesus, before Jesus came, they said they didn't have no cloak. But once he come and started stripping them naked, they needed a cloak. You're going to need a cloak in this church. And if you cover it up and keep covering it up, I'm going to tear that cloak all to pieces with the word. Here's the word. It says, it ain't going away. It's so much easier when you say, yes, Lord. Okay. That's it. I take that. I receive that. I've got no problem with it. Because if you don't, I'll be back. I'll be back. You don't want to go there. He says, for they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would not of my counsel and despise all my reproof. They despised it. Don't despise the word. Don't be a person that hates the word. The word's going to set you free. And when it comes, don't let the devil tell you, everybody looking at you. It don't matter. They got a day too. Don't get uptight. Because I'm coming for them if they don't stay in line. And so, don't look at me like, it's all right. He had to have that. And you know what I admire about you? And I gave you some pretty hard stuff when you stood up here and talk about the for my career. I said, career? Man, this is about soul and God. This ain't about career. Are you kidding me? Still on the phone. He never said a word. Well, he probably didn't have nothing to say. And he come to church to say, thank God for Mama Rose. Wow. Because there was a stick upside his head, and he was just on there. I got his wife in the process. She's sitting there grinning at me tonight. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. But everybody don't want to grin at you. I set my face. He said, if they set their face like a rock, don't let it move you. Least I confound you before them. It don't matter how they look. Don't matter whether they like it or not. Go ahead and say it. See, he knew when he called me, I would say it. I never have a problem with it. He said, you don't like my counsel. You don't like. You despise the truth. Don't despise it. Don't despise it. I was telling Niecy something a while back and something, and she was getting all upset. She always gets upset when I come to her and say, Mama, I said, just calm down, take it. One time I told the truth over at my house. She went home and fainted in the kitchen. Her husband heard something, said, boom. He had to pick her up and take her back to the room. Oh, set over the truth. I don't want you to feel like I said, I don't feel anything. I just told you what you need to get. He said, I told the Lord, from now on, I'm not going to do that no more. I'm just going to take it. And then the time I go to her, I said, what did you tell the Lord? Yeah, that's true. It doesn't matter what you think I think. It does matter what he's telling you to do. Take that. Yeah, it's rough. Word is a two-edged sword. It's going to get you on the left and on the right. When you try to straighten up, it'll cut you across the head. You try to straighten up, both legs get cut off. You thought you was getting ready to run, he cut your legs off. Because the word just keep coming. Take it! That's how we become better. Yeah, Michelle. Yes. I thought when the devil came, if you remember the time the devil came, I mean, the Lord told me years ago that he's going to try to get to her and turn her on me. But she went on a 30-day fast immediately. Some of y'all would have kept right on eating your chicken biscuits. You got to say, wait a minute. I'm not going out like that. So fasted and didn't have it. But way later, he comes through a side window. Not the same door. You recognize that. It's still scratched up where he broke in. You recognize that door. That's where he like to got me. So what do I do? Watch him. He's in the side door. I'm coming this way this time. But the same thing I tried to do then, I'm going to do now. In a different way. And you got to say no. He loves to make you mad at me. And ask me, do I care? I'm going to get you, Zach, one of these days. He just sits back there. He just gives me the thumb up. I give him the thumb up. Sitting there. If you're going to walk, you're going to do it his way. It ain't going to happen. Got the prettiest smile. Always gives me that big smile. I'm going to get you. My sister Rose seemed like a nice person. I am. I'm a nice person. I'm going to tell you the truth. And that makes me even nicer because I tell you the truth. Don't get uptight. I'm trying to get you through a situation. If you'll let me. Listen, he said, if you believe a lie, you'll be damned. You know what damned means? You'll go to hell. That's what it means. It means to condemn as a failure, to bring condemnation, and to doom you to hell. So if I don't like it, you're going to go to hell. Say, you know what? Ain't nothing that bad. I can take it. Give me some more. I can take it. Ain't nothing that bad. I can do it. I never had a problem taking the truth. I wanted it. Hey, give it to me. See? But these, throughout the word, you find people despise the word. Hate it. I felt real good this morning. Sister Rose got up and said that. And I thought, you know, she don't even consider people's feelings. Yes, I do. That's why I'm telling you. Brother Norman here, I never had to rebuke him until recent. In all them years he'd been in the church, never had to rebuke him. And he got that phone call, I couldn't hear a sound. Charles said it was so quiet you could hear a mouse peeing on cotton. Quiet! I want to say, did you hear me? Hello? I'm still here. Here it is. If you want me to respect you, you better change that. He still was quiet. Norman said he was taking it in. Most times when people get quiet, they hit them so hard until they don't have no words. So I'll wait and come back to him later and let that soak in because he ain't never had this before. He been here all these years in the ministry, never had it. And what I said was not easy to swallow. Most people want me to believe that they respect me. So I just want Sister Rose to like me. I'm going to always like you. In fact, I'm going to love you. That's why I'm going to tell you the truth. Do it feel good? No. Does not. Listen, when you start despising truth, you're in trouble. It just rubs me when she do that. Now, watch this. The person that has pride will always get exposed in a public forum. You know why? Because that breaks them down. But if you're a humble person, say, you just go to them and say, you know, the Lord said this or said that or whatever. Oh, okay, Sister Rose, okay. Brother Simmons, he's a changed man. That man is changed, I'm telling you. When he came to this church, he was stone crazy. And he was always mad with me. Because the Lord kept sending me back, telling this, telling that. Telling me, because where he came from, they didn't tell him jack. He didn't believe in them no way. He didn't trust none of them preachers. And he wasn't listening to none of them. But he got here where a preacher was for real. Now, you ain't got nothing on me to say, you telling me after what you did, you ain't got that. And I'm never going to be sure. I'm never going to give it to you. I went to that brother so many times that I had to counsel him while I ate my food because I didn't have no time to eat. I mean, my time was used up. And one time the Lord told me to go back to him. I just talked to him not long. And he says, go back to him and tell him this. So I said, Brother Simon, what is it now, sister? What is it now? Every time I look up, you're on my case. Yeah? Now, I won't be on your case when your case get right. God had to, amen, he was bullheaded, had a big head coming to church just full of it. You say, how you doing, Brother Simon? Don't talk to me. Just full of it, mean, evil. And the Lord just kept going and pop him upside the head again. Pop. Hit him again. What is it now, sister? I said, the Lord told me to tell you such and such thing. And I was eating my dinner, and he told me so and so and so and so. I thought, because as much time I got to spend with you, I don't have no time to eat my dinner. That's how bad he was. That was a trouble, man. I thought, I wish you'd have never came. Because he was so much trouble. It's like, come on. God, you sent me this hard-headed, bull-headed preacher to tell the truth. He don't want to listen to nobody. Now, if I call him, how you doing, Sister Rose? Wow. Or send me a nice card with words. I love and appreciate you for all that you've done for me. You're like a mother to me. I think I gotta save this card. Hang on to it. This ain't that person. Who is this? I'm talking never. If I call him and say, Brother Simmons, I got to tell you such and such a thing, so and so and so. He said, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. No fight. Now the devil says I'm going to give him something to fight with. Tell him, no, you ain't. I'm going to take it. See? You know what the devil does? Watch this. He isolates people. When he isolates you from around people that's doing it right, who are going to tell you the truth, he puts you by yourself, because by yourself, I can talk to you, me and you. Ain't nobody else there to counter nothing that I say. Watch isolation. You better wake up, Larry, or don't you dare come back up here in this choir and sing ever again. You in the worst spiritual condition of anybody in the church. And he's sitting there going to sleep on the word, look. The devil said, put him to sleep because, I got him anyway. I don't want him to hear the truth. Yeah. Sleeping on truth. How do you do that? Dead. I saw him in the choir. I said, what's he doing in the choir? Mom said, well, he never left the choir. He getting ready to. I said, no, I mean, every time you see him, have a message that's really strong in him. No, not in here. You're going to hear this message. So when you die and go to hell, you can't say, I didn't hear it. You're going to hear this. That's amazing. You're in that bad of shape and you're going to sleep. You're not hearing me. You're not hearing God talk to you and tell you this. Devil put you to sleep in a minute. How is they don't sleep when they're dancing and the music is going? But the minute the word comes, no, we're not taking it. We're not taking it. I'm a nice girl. Keep that in your mind. I'm a nice girl. Don't let the devil isolate you. Wherever truth is, do not get away from it. Stay where it's at, because it's going to correct you. It's going to change you. It's going to make you a different person. And you, I'm telling you, the freedom you will have is phenomenal. It's phenomenal. I gave you the truth, Baldy. There's two Baldies over there. Yeah. The Baldy on the front row. But you know what? You won't dig in till you get it. You just sit there. He said, devil got you. Go in there. He got him so bad he can't even get out. All of a sudden, God will come with a strong wind and shake you. And he can shake you for the moment. Yeah, whoa, where have I been? Because you can hear, but you don't hear. The word said they have ears to hear, but they don't hear. They have eyes to see, but they don't see. Think about it. Pay attention to what you're told. Vitally important. Let us take the most earnest heed to what we have heard, lest at any time I let it slip. Let me listen to it. Let me pay attention. Listen. See? Don't despise truth. In the last days, they will be despisers of those that are good. Good people are going to be despised. Can't stand you. I hate you. See? Oh, deal with what's on the table. It's not pretty. I know it's not pretty. I know you should be ashamed, and you should be. See? He that despised Moses' law died without mercy. Don't ever despise what the law of God is. Moses' law was what God gave him. And many despise it, and what no mercy showed to them. Don't ever despise it. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Despise authority. That's what government means. You despise. Now, I came in this church to sing Away in a Manger. And Jesus on the main line telling what you want. But don't come up here trying to push me, Sister Rowe. I never did like people trying to control my life. I don't want to control your life. God wants to control it. He's saying you made a good mess of it. Let me control your life. Let me help you. I just don't like people telling me what to do. People who despise government are self-willed. They ain't afraid to speak evil of dignities. I'm not afraid of it. You better be afraid. I said to my family, when God gets that boy and all that he's done, the sorrow you're going to feel is going to be phenomenal. It's uncomprehendable. If you were that toe up at the beginning, you were here, and now you out there, oh, my God, you should have ran. While you had the chance, you should have ran. But he didn't. Messed up. Messed up. Messed up. See? They says they scorn the truth, which simply means they have an open dislike and a disrespect, often mixed with indignation, anger. I come and say, how you doing? But when you look like a fool, I usually don't say nothing. I thought when you get through looking like a fool, you'll get it straight. They scoff. They say, how does God know? Is there knowledge in the Most High? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. They have an attitude problem. Get an attitude. Looking at me funny. I ain't the one. The postman doesn't care. I brought what Sears sent you. You paid your bill on time, you wouldn't be getting a late notice. If you prayed like you should, you wouldn't be getting a reminder. If you're doing what you need to do, that wouldn't happen. Stop for a minute. She got on me. No, I was the problem. Try to make it look like she got me. What were you doing? I don't just get people. No, I don't. You can tell when people change. I told Sarah the other day, I said, she preached Friday night. She gave y'all a chicken wing to take home. I said, you know the people of God need more than a chicken wing? Musicians, come. I said, you're going to preach 3 weeks for close of that. No, I wanted to preach. I said, you did? Yeah, I did. I said, why didn't you go on? Why'd you cut it off in 25 minutes? You ain't finished feeding me. I need another piece of chicken. some greens with it, some other stuff. What are you doing? Cutting it off. 25 minutes. It was 25 minutes, bro. I said, that makes it even worse. I said, from now on, all you preachers preach at least 45 minutes to an hour. Don't even think of 30 minutes. Just pass it. I said, I'm going to put you up for 3 weeks. Can I have another chance? No. Well, you say you want to preach. Why you ask for another chance? Those things don't go together, do they? Can I have, like she's being punished. Can I have another chance? This isn't a punishment. This is that get up there and feed the people of God. Aroka, I really wanted to preach. That's the first time in my life that I dreamed about the message. Well, you should have kept giving it to them. Why didn't you give them some more? They're hungry. Give them all of it. Fill up the plate, baby. No, you got 3 weeks. Oh, you're going to be, Lord, please. 3 weeks in a row? But I preach every now and then. I can take that, but don't push it. I don't understand that because I can never preach enough. I'm never saying, I don't want to preach. I always want to preach. Even when they say, Mama, let somebody do it for I want to preach. What's wrong with these preachers? This is a great calling here. See? None calleth for justice, Isaiah says, nor any pleaded for truth. They trust in vanity. They speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. Jeremiah says, they will deceive everyone his neighbor and will not speak the truth. They have taught their tongues to speak lies and weary themselves to commit iniquity. They're tired from just doing wrong. So I said, bro, God has changed me. I said, we're going to see in 3 weeks. 3 weeks straight. See, they ain't been getting up preaching. They sitting back. You know what they do when it goes for a little while? Take the coat and let me put this off. Look like we got a little time. You better put that preacher coat back on. Because the least time you and I should, in that time, some preacher should have said to me, Sister Rose, can I preach? I'm, God, I'm full of it. I said, what? Come on up here, brother. Mm-mm. Yeah. Right. I ain't said nothing. Only person who mentioned to me was P. P said, Mom, you need me to preach. I'm ready to preach. I should shut up, Brother Simmons. Just shut up. Shut up. Trying to fix it. I'm not going to accept it. But you got to speak, and you got to speak truth and deal with it. So here's what I'm trying to understand. If she wanted to preach so bad, why did she tell Juana when Juana said, Sarah, go back and get your Bible? And went, are you kidding me? That don't sound like you're ready to preach. I would say, okay, praise God, I'll be right back. That's what that sounds like somebody that want to preach. You thought, are you kidding me? I thought, all that time, it's been weeks since they preached. I'm going to get some of the rest of them. I ain't going to tell them every Friday night. You up, brother. Come up. Hey, brother, you up. Hey, brother, you up. Hey, brother, you up. Like, what's going on? Like, here she come again. I've been up there 5 times. When is this going to end? It ain't going to end. You a preacher. Preacher's supposed to preach. See, that's what it's about. And you got to tell these people about doing the truth, saying what's truth and accepting truth because you accept it. Oh. Now, as Janus and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds and reprobate concerning the faith. They withstood Moses on truth. They still want to withstand it. Don't become a despiser of the word. Say, this is something I look forward to because I'm going to be better. I'm not going to take a nap, Sister Rose. I want to hear this because I need to get my life right. I'm listening to you, Sister Rose. Are you really? This is her trouble. Now, when one of the ministers is preaching, and when they come back home, I said, what did they preach about? You don't know what he preached about? He just preached. It was good. Well, if you didn't eat any of it, how do you know it's good? Sitting there looking goofy. What did they say? Yeah. They said, he mentioned something about, what was that? Honey, you're supposed to get enough word that you could tell, yeah, this is exactly what the message was about. It caused me to think. It caused me to change my mind. Yes. Yes. Don't hate truth. The worst thing you could do for yourself. See, he said unto Ezekiel, eat this roll. Go speak unto the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he caused me to eat that roll. And he said unto me, son of man, cause thy belly to eat it. And fill thy bowels with this roll that I give thee. Then did I eat it, and it was in my mouth as honey for sweetness. People who love the word, who willing to take it, it's good to them. Nobody despises the word who loves it. It's making me a different person. It's changing my life. That's what God's trying to do to you. You one of those little fellas, little tiny fella, and God put you over in the pot. I look back, God look back, you crawling out the pot. Sit on the outside, man. Woo! He come and put you back in the pot again. Wow! Feels good, and it's hot too. Come on back to church. You look like he's really got it together. God comes and grabs you by your little self, throw you back in the pot. He said, take a walk out. Don't work out. Okay. But when I look at you, I think, wow, a vessel. If he stays in the pot, what God will do with you, it is amazing. You will be amazed. But you got to get in that pot and say, see, one time he put me in, and I tried to get out too, but the pot was too big. Every time I tried to get up on the side of it, I slide back down in there. So I know that feeling. But you got to understand that God is trying to take this vessel that's messed up, break it into pieces, mold it again, and do what needs to be done because it don't function right. Trying to fix that. And that's why the devil said, you can think about your career. No, you need to think about your soul. When it's all said and done, career don't matter. But whether my soul is right and ready to meet God, that matters. I don't have to be old to die. No, I don't have to be old. It could be, you cannot be very old. Young people die early. People die early. Think about it. Is it, do I know how much time I've got left? No, none of us do. And so what you going to do? I'm going to do what's right. I'm going to follow the word. It's very important. Paul said, I didn't fight against it anymore. You know why? Because I found it very hard to kick against it. You try to kick against God if you want to, you end up with a broke ankle, a broke leg, in two places. Didn't have no reason to break that leg. That's just a simple step. Nobody breaks their leg just stepping down. God said, I'm going to have to break your leg. You're not getting the message. Broke it in two places. The doctor said, this is very unusual. That's all you did? Yeah, just stepped down and it broke. God said, I'm going to have to put you down for some. I said, be careful, you'll break it again. All this stuff. It ain't just a regular break. It got to have surgery. I'm going to set you down for a while, have somebody pushing you around. Push you around. Here you come in church. Look at Zach back there. Somebody pushing you around. Now, God said, I'll let you walk by yourself if you do what I say. You won't have to have nobody to push you. You know, have to wait for somebody to come and push you over there, push you over here. I mean, you could be rid of that in a moment. But no, you just sitting there with your little raggedy blue jeans on and smiling. And you got on the colors of the United States of America. nobody. I'm not going to get you. That's what I'm trying to figure with these preachers. They done in 25 minutes. This is how much, if you look at the paper clips here, I never got to this. I never got here. So how do you run out? So Sarah, how you run out? I'm never out. I'm always go home with the, oh, I wish I could have got to the rest of those scriptures that I never got to. Because I'm so busy telling you what you need to do, and I was going to get. See, when I study, I always have tons of scripture. I know I'm not going to preach all them scriptures, but they're here. If I need to hit it, it's here. So if you're telling, well, that's all I got, y'all. Huh? You better quit bringing them chicken wings up in here and bring the whole chicken. I'm going home chewing on the bone. I wish I had another piece of chicken. Oh. Feed me till I want no more. Feed me. Oh. If my family, one of these preachers come up, I'm getting ready to close and let y'all go home. One of these preachers come up in my family, they know when they messed up. Here they come in the house. He come in and stood behind the chair. I said, you know you made a mess, don't you? Yeah, man. What, mama, what's going on? You asking me? You know what's going on. You ain't done what you should have done. Don't be looking at me. God don't leave us hanging in the pulpit. I'm going to give you something to give the people. So you can understand when you hear the word, quit hating it. Quit throwing it away. Quit saying, I don't like her. She made me feel guilty about everything when I went to that church. I'm not going back. I don't care if you come back. You got it. You got it. Yes. Stand to your feet. What's going on, man? Devil is a lie. No, he ain't. He got you. If you do what you need to do, God ain't never going to put you up here with nothing. We all remember Michelle's beautiful saying. She getting mic'd up and everything. No, you ain't got no message. Why don't you stop it then and say, hey, don't put the mic on me. I ain't got no message. Put the mic on, come on up front and say, I don't have a message. They say if you don't give yourself to God, but you don't have one. And I don't have one. I'm sitting there like this here. In all my years of being a preacher, I never heard nothing like that before. I don't have anything for you. I know you're hungry, but lick your fingers because I'm out of here. Lift your hands. Father, we love you today. We praise you. We glorify your name. We lift up your name. Hallelujah. Thank you for the victory tonight. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for caring, God, speaking to the hearts of your people. Cause them to wake up and take a look. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Give him a song. Yes.